Thanks for coming. So I'm going to give you a crash course in writing a script, right? So we're going to do that in 45 minutes or so. And maybe you have some good ideas about scripts, some stories, things you really like. So you have some kind of idea about a climactic battle like me. A brilliant scene around a dinner table conflict between one lone man and a herd of rabid cyborg buffalo. And you have to make that work. So I thought I'd start with a clip that maybe you've seen this before. This is actually a trailer. It's a real movie that came out a couple of years ago that was a total flop. But I think it's quite useful. Thank you.
Whoa, feedback.
All right, let's try this.
This is the voiceover for a comedian movie trailer. Take one.
In a world where laughter was king.
No in a world, Jack.
What do you mean, no in a world?
It's not that kind of movie.
Oh? Okay. In a land that...
No in a land either.
In a time...
Nah, I don't think so.
In a land before time.
It's about a comedian, Jack.
One man.
No.
When your life is no longer your own.
What does that mean?
When everything you know is wrong.
That's wrong.
In an outpost.
No.
On the edge of space.
No space.
A girl.
No.
Two girls.
No.
Now.
No.
More than ever.
Stop it.
A renegade cop.
I hate you.
A robot renegade cop.
You're fired.
You're fired.
No, you're actually fired.
I'm fired.
Get out of the booth, Jack.
No. I like it in here.
It's a great trailer, right? What's he doing there? It's like every cliche you've ever heard, right? That's what kind of makes it funny, those cliches. And that's one of the big issues in screenwriting is how do you not have cliches? How do you do that thing? I want to tell that story about one man. No, one man. And everything's been done. So how do you tell a story when everything's been done already? In fact, how do you even tell a story? How do you even put it together? Well, I'm glad you've asked that. And you have in front of you, did everybody get one of those handouts? The basic parts of a script. These are the basic building blocks where they go. And I'm trying to give you this short minute how to do this and not make it like this Jerry Seinfeld trailer for Comedian. Okay? The trailer's probably better than the whole movie ever was. These are the basic parts. They all matter. And I'm going to go through them briefly and kind of go over what's significant here and what isn't. If you don't use these parts to a screenplay, you can try that. And some filmmakers do. And sometimes they're successful, and most of the time they're not. Okay, so as we go through them, if I may, there's this really delicate balance between being original and fresh and doing something really, really clever with structure, like playing around with that structure, and falling flat on your face. Right? So how do you do that to be original and I'm going to tell the story a different way? And it doesn't work most of the time. Anybody seen Koi on a Scotsy? Yeah, I rest my case. First thing is, and some of these I think you have on that list and some you don't. Well, the first one is the title. Right? Title, you can start with a title. That's kind of a great way to start. You do some write books as well. You start with a title, and then you aim for that title, and then you realize halfway through, I got to change that title. You can't own that. Right? You just got to put it out there. That's your working title. Log line, that's on your little let me get one of theirs. Log line. It says, whole film in one engaging sentence. This is what you use to pitch to people, but it's a great exercise when you're writing. Can you state your whole story in one sentence? If it's a good story for a script, you ought to be able to do that. Okay? Want to try one? Want to give me an example of one? Pick a film, any film. There you go. How about, that's actually was my example. Thank you for ruining my home. A small resort town is threatened by a killer shark. That's all of Jaws. Jaws, by the way, is a brilliant example of really tight screenwriting. It does everything. Really fantastic in ways that makes your head spin when you start taking it apart because it's so simple. But that's like lots of good writing. So it matters, right? This is how you sell it for $1 million. Good films tend to do this easily. I'm trying to think of something that's, how about, well, I haven't seen Lego, the Lego movie. What have I got here? Gladiator. A deposed Roman general has to fight back to win his honor. Right? I mean, that's kind of it. If you can do that with your story, one line, the log line, the pitch line, the one, that's really good. If you start, two guys who are from a fraternity are captured by aliens and taken to the fifth dimension where they meet, bring it down. That's the log line. Premise. Premise is a really great way. Let's keep with the Jaws thing. The premise is sort of what's acting here? What's going on? What's behind the scenes here? It's a way to sort of organize your thoughts. What if a deadly shark started to attack swimmers in a small resort town at the height of summer vacation time? Right? You got a premise for this? Controlling premise. See, there's the premise. What if? And then the controlling premise is, what's the point of your premise? How's that going to play out? Okay? So, for example, let me give you the Jaws one again. Sorry, I switched tracks there. I don't want the controlling premise of Jaws yet. I'm going to do more things with that later. What's the point of your premise? What if? What if, right? And then the controlling premise. So how about this for an example? Amadeus. Okay? Here's the premise. What if a jealous composer conspired to have Mozart work himself to death? And then the controlling premise is, can we become so enraged with jealousy that we will kill and that will drive us mad? Okay? You got a what if, and then what do you do with that what if? The controlling premise. Right? And that's really interesting to ask that question. What if? It's also dreadfully exciting, isn't it? What if aliens came down? What if I won the lottery? What if the girl of my dreams was coming after me, and then what happened, right? And then you have to find out some way what to do with that, the controlling premise, okay? Do you want to try one of those? No, it's just like, no, I don't want to try any of those. Put me on the spot. By the way, I'm really pleased with my red solo cup, because you don't know what's in it, just like nobody knows what's in it when you're Friday night out on the... Okay. The inciting incident. This is the one that really gets you going here. McKee, the guy the writer of the textbook that we use in screenwriting, and he's also like the big giant of screenwriting, he says, this inciting incident is what radically upsets the balance of forces in the protagonist's life. The inciting incident is what starts the ball rolling. And what's great is when you realize this, when you start to look for this in films, it's always there. Always. There's always an inciting incident. There's always something that... It can be as simple as the opening of a film is a funeral, right? Somebody just died. That's an inciting incident. It can be as simple as somebody just wins something or just graduates, right? You graduate from school, it's an inciting incident in your life. Things are going to change. Or it can be something else entirely. I'm going to show you one in just a second. This is the first time, this inciting incident, when the protagonist does not get what he wants. Okay? It's the first incident where that doesn't happen. He wants this and it's not going to happen. Something falls down. Something doesn't connect. It has to incite. All right? That's a really great thing. You can look for this. Every film that you watch, look for that inciting incident and you'll start seeing. You go, yeah, that's it. And some writers can really sneak in. I'm going to show you a really, really great one here right now. Which is, I don't want that one. And sorry, how do I get to this one? Okay. This I'm persuaded is the real inciting incident in Jaws. It's not when he finds, the beginning of Jaws, when the girl goes swimming. She's swimming, the shark eats her, and then Brody, the sheriff, finds her on the beach. Okay? That's maybe the little inciting incident, but this is the one that's going to spin it in a completely different direction.
Martin, there are all kinds of sharks in the waters, you know? Hammerheads, white tips, blues, makos. And the chances that these bozos got the exact shark...
Oh, there's no other sharks like this in these waters.
It's 100 to 1. 100 to 1. Now, I'm not saying that this is not the shark. It probably is, Martin. It probably is. It's a man-eater. It's extremely rare for these waters. But the fact is that the bite radius on this animal is different than the wounds on the victim. I want to be sure. You want to be sure. We all want to be sure, okay? And what I want to do is very simple. The digestive system of this animal is very, very slow. Let's cut it open. Whatever it's eaten in the last 24 hours is bound to still be in there, and then we'll be sure.
Maybe the only way to confirm is, huh?
Look, fellas, let's be reasonable, huh? This is not the time or the place to perform some kind of a half-assed autopsy on a fish. And I am not going to stand here and see that thing cut open and see that little Kentner boy spill out all over the dock.
Chief Brody?
Yes?
I just found out that a girl got killed here last week. And you knew it. You knew there was a shark out there. You knew it was dangerous. But you let people go swimming anyway. You knew all those things. But still, my boy is dead now. And there's nothing you can do about it. My boy is dead. I wanted you to know that.
I'm sorry, Martin. She's wrong.
No, she's not.
No, she's totally not wrong, right? Now, there's a lot in that whole scene that's really, really great, not the least of which we'll get to in a minute, is conflict, conflict, conflict. The conflict in this movie never lets up. And it goes right from the conflict even where he has to make decisions. We found the shark. It's not the shark. We got the shark. It's not him. People in the back are it's pressure. There's the town's mayor's there. It's pressure, pressure, conflict, conflict. And then this moment, pow, when she busts him across the face. Now, in a way, I was thinking about how to say this, and it's kind of corny, right, because it's so hackneyed what we say all the time. But what this is, what this does is, now it's personal, right? But it is. And now it just spins that. That incites Brody. Now he's moving ahead and nothing will stop him, right? He is on it now. That incites him for the rest of the movie. That Kittner boy. Ooh, it's so good. Can you set up Gladiator? All right. I'm back. Just briefly then. It's really interesting about gaps. Do you see that below? The protagonist issue, I'm going to come back to that. What does a protagonist want? You see gaps 1 and 2? Gaps 1 and 2 are, this is something you can also look for in a lot of scripts. It's really fascinating in films. It's like an inciting incident, and it has to do with the conflict, the unfulfillment of a dramatic desire and of a conflict that happens and reaches a certain point. Often these are thought of as plot points. It might be where a major turn of the story goes. This scene, the Jaws scene, could be thought of a little bit as one of those gaps. The short way of thinking about it is, it's something that the protagonist wants, and we see them wanting it, we get that they want it, and they're not going to get it. Okay? It's a gap. That gap opens up. The easiest way to think about this are love stories, rom-coms, right? Romantic comedy. In a romantic comedy, you don't have the guy and the girl meet each other in the first scene, really like each other, get together, and then get married in, you know, like 5 minutes later. That doesn't work. That's not a story, right? What does every romantic comedy need? There's actually a brilliant one. I don't know if you still have that link for the website, but there's a great website where someone spoofs how to write a romantic comedy script. Think about a romantic comedy. What do they all have? How do they work? Boy meets girl. Boy meets Jennifer Aniston, okay? And then what happens? You know this. They fall in love? What happens? The gap opens, right? They They fall in love. They meet each other. They fall in love. Oh, but they're pushed apart because the old boyfriend shows up. The old girlfriend shows up. And it's not going to work. And see, and they come in. Hello! They get. Now, some screenwriters say those gaps get bigger. Okay? So first it's just a little one. Oh, how will our careers ever, you know, own? It looks like they're on the thing. And then, oh, but it's okay. Our love will overcome the careers. And then, oh, but I have terminal cancer. And I'm not going to. Oh, and it's a gap. And they're never, ever going to get together. But then there's a miraculous cure. And then you have the climax. We're getting there in just a minute. Okay? Here's one. Let me see. Consciously or not, this is interesting for the viewer. We want them to get it, right? We want the protagonist to get it. Well, of course, a romantic comedy, they have to fall in love and get married and be happy forever. That's what it is. By the way, if you mess with that, there will be bloodshed, right? Your audience, the women, will come and beat you to death. So we want the protagonist to get this, all right? So I'm going to show you this scene, which is, of course, the best scene in the whole movie. Rain and I were talking about this. It's a great moment in Gladiator that kind of, it's a little bit less clear than other examples, but it's a gap that opens up. It's also an inciting incident here, okay? So you know this one.
Drop your weapons. Gladiator, the Emperor has asked for you.
I'm at the Emperor's service.
Well-deserved, Spaniard. I don't think there's ever been a gladiator to match you.
As for this young man,
he insists you are Hector reborn.
What's it, Hercules?
Why doesn't the hero reveal himself and tell us all your real name? You do have a name.
My name is Gladiator.
How dare you show your back to me? Slave! You will remove your helmet and tell me your name.
My name is Maximus Decimus Meridius, commander of the armies of the North, general of the Felix Legions, loyal servant to the true emperor, Marcus Aurelius, father to a murdered son, husband to a murdered wife, and I will have my vengeance in this life or the next.
But he's not going to have it now, is he? Right? That gap opens. He wants that. We want him to get that. There's a lot of other things that happen in this. One that's really interesting, there's a lot of elements here. One is that in a really profound way, he's already won. I mean, just this. Turns his back on the emperor, right? And he's already this total kicking leader of men. He's already established all of those things. He's already a hero. We already love him. How can we love him more? How can he be greater, right? That's fantastic. All of that's in there. So it's sort of nice. Ridley Scott stacks all these things up there. It's great. Okay. Even if he can't get it, he still sort of wins. And of course, you know that's how the film ends, right? Because in the end, he does kill the bad guy. He does have vengeance, but he dies. What does he gain? What does he want? Justice. Does he want to live? No, not really, because he's going to go to heaven and be there with his wife and son. Somehow in a field as he walks with his hands on the wheat. Right? But it's all, okay. Sorry, can you set up Winslow Boy? This is another example I've got of this gap. The gap thing is really more obvious in films that are of a kind of really popular kind of, I'd say that, a Saturday adventure movie, cop movies, right? How does the cop wants what? To get the bad guy. So he tries to get the bad guy the first time, but the bad guy gets away. Then he tries to get the bad guy the second time, but this time the bad guy is taken hostage, and he can't get the bad guy, and the bad guy gets away. And then something's got to happen at the end. We're getting that's a climax, and that's a little bit different. That's a gap, but it has to be resolved. This is a film I think you probably haven't seen before. It's based on a David Mamet play. And Mamet movies are really good. Spanish Prisoner and what's the other? Bother. He's done several film versions that are really bad of some. But he's a great playwright. It's kind of cheating in a way because the words are theatrical and really, really great. And that's what's great about this particular scene. And I'll set it up for you when we get there. Sorry, you got it? There it is. 129? 129.20. Oh, I'm sorry, 4620. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay, so this is a really, really simple story. The Winslow boy is this young man, and he was a student at a boarding school. It's a naval school. So he was a student there, and he gets accused of stealing another student's postal order. It's like a little check thing that they went down and wrote. And so he's bound and determined. His father is there's some class issues in this because it's England in the teens and 20s. And his father is a solid kind of middle class guy who believes his son to be innocent and says, we want justice from him. They throw him out of school and they smear the kid's record and the kid says, I didn't do it. And his dad says, I believe you. So in seeking out justice, they seek the help of Sir Mortimer. I can't remember his first name, but it's Mortimer. And they want him to help the family. So he's an aristocrat. He's also an attorney. And they want him. They're going to seek him out. So this is the first meeting when the family, the father has a beard. You'll recognize him. And then Gemma Jones, she's the mom. And then there's a sister there as well and a family solicitor, a family attorney in the background. And then this guy, Sir Morton, I can't remember his whole name. And he's reviewing some aspects of the kid's story, okay? So they're hoping that he'll take the case, take the brief.
I would like to cast your mind back to December the 7th of last year. Will you tell me in your own words exactly what happened to you on that day?
It was half holiday, so we didn't have any work after dinner.
Dinner at 1 o'clock?
Yes, at least until prep at 7.
Prep at 7.
Well, then, just before dinner, I went along to the chief petty officer and asked him to let me have 15 and 6 out of what I had in the school bank.
Why did you do that?
I wanted to buy an air pistol.
Which cost 15 and 6?
Yes, sir.
And how much money did you have in the school bank at the time?
£2.03.
So you see, what incentive could he possibly... I must ask you to be good enough not to interrupt me, sir. After you had withdrawn the 15 and 6, what did you do?
I had dinner.
Then what?
Then I went to the locker room and put my 15 and 6 away in my locker. Then I went to go and get permission to go to the post office.
Yes?
Then I went back to the locker room, again got out my money and went down to the post office.
Yes, go on.
Then, I bought my postal order.
I see. Did you cash a postal order belonging to Elliot Minor for 5 shillings?
No, sir.
Did you break into his locker and steal it?
No, sir.
And that is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, sir.
Right.
The files, please.
This is just coming out from Ridley Pierce.
When the commander asked you to write Elliot's name on an envelope, how did you write it? With Christian name or initials?
I wrote Charles K. Elliot.
Charles K. Elliot. And did you by any chance happen to see the forged postal order in the commander's office?
Yes, sir. The commander showed it to me.
Before or after you'd written Elliot's name on the envelope?
After.
After. And did you happen to see how Elliot's name was written on the postal order?
Yes, sir. The same.
The same?
Yes.
Charles. And oddly enough, in the exact form in which you had earlier been practicing writing his signature.
I say, which side are you on?
Yes, all right. You were. Are you aware that the Admiralty sent up the forged postal order to Mr. Ridgely Pierce, the greatest handwriting expert in England?
Yes.
You are aware of that. And you know that Mr. Ridgely Pierce affirmed that there was no doubt that the signature on the postal order and the signature which you wrote on the envelope were by one and the same hand?
Yes.
And you still say you didn't forge that signature?
Yes, I do.
In other words, Mr. Ridgely Pierce doesn't know his job.
Well, he's wrong, anyway.
Is he indeed?
What did you say?
Are you aware?
I said, come down to the post office with me. I'm going to cash a postal order.
Cash a postal order?
I mean get.
You said cash. Why did you say cash if you meant get?
I don't know.
I suggest cash was the truth.
No, no, it wasn't really. You're muddling me.
You seem easily muddled. How many other lies have you told?
None, really, I haven't.
I suggest your whole testimony is a lie.
No, it's the truth.
I suggest there is barely one single word of truth in anything you've said either to me or to the judge advocate or to the commander. I suggest that you broke into Elliot's locker, that you stole the postal order for 5 shillings belonging to Elliot, that you cashed it by means of forging his name.
I didn't.
I suggest that you did it for a joke, meaning to give Elliot the 5 shillings back, but that when you met him and he said he'd reported the matter, you got frightened and decided to keep quiet.
No, no, it isn't true. It isn't true. None of it's true.
I suggest that by continuing to deny your guilt, you are causing great hardship to your family and considerable annoyance to high and important persons in this country.
That's a disgraceful thing to say.
I suggest that the time has at last come for you to undo some of the misery you've caused by confessing to us all now that you are a forger, a liar, and a thief.
How dare! I'm not! I didn't do it!
This is outrageous, sir.
I didn't do any of it!
It's all right, though. It's all right.
Kari, can I drop you anywhere?
No, I...
Send all of his files here by tomorrow morning.
But will you need them now?
Oh, yes, the boy is plainly innocent. I accept the brief.
Brilliant! You got to watch the film, it's really great. What happens there? He's going to be the hope, he's set up as the hope, right? So you want this guy, Robert Morton, you want Morton to take the case. And they go to see Morton, and then I say, whose side are you on? Right? And he's drilling the kid. And he's making the kid look. And then the kid says to cash the... And he goes, I suggest you are lying. And you're causing considerable hardship to high and important persons in this country. This is a great, great line, right? No, it's not true. It's not, this is an outrage, sir. What a despicable thing to say. You are a forger, a liar, and a thief. And you're just like, no, all their hopes are dashed. This is it. Oh, we'll take it. The boy's plainly innocent. What? Oh, yeah, because that's what lawyers do. Right? So it's a great, bam, it's that gap. The gap opens, it's not good, and then they finally get some. There's something that's accomplished there. They haven't won yet, but there's this lovely flip that happens there, in that moment there. Okay, so what's the ultimate gap? The ultimate flip, the ultimate change, if you will, is the climax. Okay? And the climax of a story is when that gap opens up and you set up your protagonist to resolve that gap in a way that's the end of all possibilities, okay? That might sound a bit abstract, but it's really easy when you think of, say, Jaws, right? There's only one way Jaws can end. Shark must die, right? That's it. Cop movie, there's only one way a cop movie can end, essentially. Bad guy's in prison, bad guy's shot, falls off a building, face is blown up, something, right? It has to be something like that. There's only one way Star Wars can end, right? The Death Star must be stopped. And then if you add the trilogy to it, Vader must be stopped, right? That climax has to be the last step, where after that you can't imagine anything else, okay? You can't have him almost kill the shark and then go, oh, well, he got away. That's just the way life is sometimes. Right? No way. It has to be the absolute finish. Now, that's a little bit delicate. You got to make it make sense. It has to make sense, right? It can't be something like, oh, we almost got the shark, but instead we killed all life in the ocean just to get rid of... What? Well, we dropped a poison and killed all life, so we got rid of the shark. No, it doesn't make any sense, right? And you also, you know, the classic one is Deus Ex Machina, right? You can't have suddenly God go, oh, there, I fixed it. No, that's not satisfying, right? We want that protagonist. We want him to get that desire, that object of desire. He must fulfill that thing that he wants in some way or another. Something must satisfyingly be resolved where you can't imagine anything else to be resolved after that. Rocky. Rocky's kind of interesting. It's a little bit like the Gladiator clip. Rocky doesn't win at the end of Rocky, remember? And yet, he does win, which is a great kind of ending. It's a little tweak on that. He doesn't win, but he wins because he gets the girl and he accomplished something. It was great because it would have been a terrible movie, I think, if they had him win at the end. It would have just been like every other and just wouldn't have done it. Truman Show. Oh, man. Truman Show, that character is so sympathetic. We know what Truman wants. How do you even put that into words? He wants the truth, right? What is that he wants? He wants to be free? I mean, the metaphor in the movie is he wants to go to Fiji or he wants to leave the island where he lives. But we know he wants the world. He wants to have the falseness removed. And at the end, there's that brilliant moment where it's a bit sarcastic. And if I don't see you later, good day, good afternoon, and good night. And he bows, and he walks off stage. It's almost theatrical, right? And he has the conflict. He has the showdown with the god figure, Christoph. And he conquers, he overcomes the storm to get there. And he sees a bit of reality when the ship, that great moment, when the prow of the ship goes and crashes into the set. What? It's crazy. And then he knows he's going to be free. And you know he's going to be free. The music helps there. And then he also gets the girl. Right? It's implied that he gets the girl. Great moment. There's not going to be, like, the Truman 2. This time he's not taking it anymore. And he's going to come back and kill Christoph. It doesn't, right? It's not going to work like that. Okay, a quick note on genre. You know what a genre is? It's not genre, which is how I used to pronounce it. Genre, what's genre? The type, right? The kind of categorization. So what's a categorization? Give me one example. Action movie, right? An action movie, there's something that an action movie has to have in it. You know what that is? Action, right? You have to have action in it. You can't not. If it's a kind of a murder detective movie, guess what there has to be in there? A murder and a detective. And then you have to find the guilty party. And God help you if you mess with those, right? Because your audience will come looking for you. My biggest gripe I have with films that mess around with this are comedies. You ever seen a comedy that starts off as a comedy and then becomes some kind of weird emotional roller coaster and you just go, no, see, I paid my $7, $8, $50, whatever it is, to see something funny. Don't try to make it into a serious drama. When people start messing about with genres, that can really, really screw up. Now, you can also have some fun with that, right? You can have a musical detective comedy. You could try, you know, people try these things, and sometimes you can, and because your audience is incredibly sophisticated, you can kind of play off of those a bit like the comedian trailer, right? In a different time, in a world beyond time, and you can kind of tweak your audience a little bit, and that's great fun to set them up for expectations, and they go, pah, and slam, go, oh, pay attention now, because you're not getting what you think you're going to get, but then you have to make sure that they get something better than what they were expecting. Okay? So genre, don't mess with that too much. Right, so quick tips. Here we go. Yes, the good old 3x5 card. This is a technique that McKee recommends. I've not tried this technique. I always thought a better technique was a little Moleskine notebook that you carry around. You know, George Lucas carried around a notebook everywhere he went, and he kept one by his bed, so when he woke up and he had a dream, he could write down what he dreamt all the time. McKee says, carry 3x5 cards with you. He says, do not sit down and write your entire script all at once. It'll suck. Because what will happen is you're just going to cut. He says, no, you put ideas on cards. You put an idea for a character. You put an idea for a scene. You put an idea for dialogue, a setting, a time period, special effects, whatever that is. And you make lots and lots and lots and lots of these. And then when you have several hundred of them, then you start laying them out. And you start seeing. And then you can go, no, cut. But at least you've got something to go on then. You've got some scenes. You've got something there to edit and to build from. Okay? I think it's really interesting. Right? Yes? Culling lots? Right? Good. This helps us. This helps in the editing process. I don't know how much stuff you've written already, but it's hard to dissect your baby. Right? You write your script and you lend it to a friend, and your friend goes, I really liked the setting. And you can't, but but that scene, that one scene was so great. And your friend goes, but there's no way you can't cut that scene. You're holding on to it too tight. McKee says, don't. You can't hold on to anything too tight. In fact, if you're holding on to it that tight, that's probably the one thing you should cut. Right? So just, it's easier, he says, the card system. You work through the cards. A basic principle of screenwriting, and indeed of many kinds of writing, is show, don't tell. You got to show it, not tell it, right? It's the most basic rule. If you're telling instead of showing, then as McKee says, you might as well be reading the newspaper, right? The newspapers are just about telling. Here's what happened. It's not some interpretive thing. Showing is something really weird and different that happens. You represent some idea. You show something there. I mean, it's hard to be brave when you're out on sea and a giant shark is going to attack your boat, right? But then you show guys out on a boat, and they're struggling. None of the three characters in Jaws who are out on the boat go, man, this is really scary with just the three of us out here. They don't have to, right? That's the whole thing. It shows you that, right? So you don't want to do that. By the way, this is all the research papers you'll ever write in the world. You don't tell. That's not what your paper's about. You're showing. You're giving examples, but you're showing this. All the time I sit on students' papers. You let your reader decide. Okay. Related to that is the biggest, most verboten principle of screenwriting ever, which is exposition, which is telling. No. You don't do exposition. I don't know how familiar you are with the movie Dune from 1984. It was criticized as, I quote, the greatest motion picture disappointment of 1984. And it was. People waited 30 years for that movie to be made, 24 years for that movie to be made from the time the books came out. And it just sucked. And one of the most, I remember hearing Siskel and Ebert, right, Roger Ebert, no, he just died recently, didn't he? Talking about this, and I remember when I went to go see it, because I was like, freak, yes, Herbert's book, finally. When you got to the cinema, they handed you a sheet of paper that was a lexicon of terms, front and back. I think I've kept mine somewhere. And Ebert just said, what? And then when you sit in when the movie starts, there's like 10 minutes of one figure there explaining. Dune, Arrakis, there's a planet. The universe is arranged like this, and there's these different families, and it's exposition, exposition, exposition. 10 minutes in, and half the audience is asleep. You never just tell. Here's the whole setup there. You just give the minimal amount of information. McKee has this great, great, great line. You do not keep the audience's interest by giving it information, but by withholding information. Okay, if I can make a television reference, the entire series of Lost was based on that one idea. We're not going to tell you anything, right? And they could run with that for a while, which was 6 seasons. But now, I don't know if you know this, but in like 17 European countries, there's a death sentence on Damon Lindelof's head for this and J.J. Abrams for what they did at the end of Lost because there was no payoff there. Were you guys Lost victims, so to speak? Because of that, you're like, come on. Galactica also did kind of similar kind of thing. They made all these promises that hook you in. We're holding information. And you go, whoa, what is that? This is detective movies do this. Who could it be? Right? And you want to know. It hooks you in. So that's good, but you got to have a payoff at the end. There's got to be that payoff there. Okay? Convert exposition to ammunition. Great idea. Withhold that information. Inception, I think, is a really clever example of this. Inception is a complicated world, right? There's all these rules in that world. But they don't exposit them. They show them to us. Do you remember when? There's a whole sequence when they're showing you how it works. When they take Juno, Ellen Page. When DiCaprio takes Ellen Page into the dream. And he explains it all right there to her. But it's not exposition. He's shown this is how it works, right? And then that's really great. So And you know in films when they go to great lengths to explain things like that, you know it's never going to work that way, right? It's setting up like, hey, here's our plan. First it explains the world, then here's our plan for what we're going to do, and you know, yeah, that's never going to happen. And one of the bits of information that they hold back is, was it the fourth level? Right? There's something about the subconscious they're hinting at. They're foreshadowing about the subconscious, about DiCaprio's subconscious. But then the fourth level? Wait, what? 50 years? What? What? And you're like, no. And it's great. It just pulls you right in. Bam. You with me on this? Yes, we're with you. It's great. Okay. Good. Complicated rules. Other really, really basic thing for when you start working on your screenplay. Conflict. Conflict, 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 conflict. There's always conflict. There's no drama without conflict. There must be conflict. You cannot have a scene without conflict. Even if it's a little bitty conflict, there's conflict. Otherwise, it's just telling. Nothing's happening. Man, there's so many examples of films like this where you watch the first 10 minutes and you just go. The one we watched, remember Legend? Tom Cruise bomb from the mid-80s. Ridley Scott, spectacular little, I mean, visually mind-blowing film. Tangerine Dream soundtrack that's fantastic. And the film just sucks. It's amazing. The first 10 minutes in, nothing happens. You don't care about any of the characters. It's not making any sense. Nothing happens. It's really, really frustrating. That inciting incident, that gets lost. There's got to be conflict. Here's what McKee says. True character is revealed in the choices a human being makes under pressure. The greater the pressure, the deeper the revelation. The truer the choice to the character's essential nature. We want to see those characters squirm. We want to see Maximus squirm. Pressure, 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 because we know he's going to rise above it. It's great, right? We want to see that cop have to hustle to make this work because we know he's going to win in the end. Okay? These conventions are there, but they're good. You can use them or you cannot. Okay. There's a little magic device in here. That you can consider. It's a great device for telling stories. And it goes like this. What does the protagonist want? What do they want? But what does the protagonist really want? Okay? What does Maximus want? He wants revenge. But what does he really want? It's not just revenge. It's bigger than that. And the film ends on a bigger note. It's something about a just world or a good world. He's not after self. You know, he doesn't want to just have to be the hero. He wants to make the world better, and we get a little hint of that from Marcus Aurelius in the beginning, you know, about making the world a better place, and, you know, I kind of failed at that, and I believe in the Rome that Marcus Aurelius taught, and there's a few characters in the film that kind of are hinting at some of this. It's not just that simple. This kind of separates the men from the boys, if you will. Cop movie, he just wants revenge. Die Hard, no, he just wants to kill the bad guy. He doesn't want some global notion of justice. No, you just kill the bad guy, that's enough. But then there's other films where it's more than that. What do you want? Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs? You need to watch it. Brilliant, brilliant screenplay. What does the protagonist want? What does Flynn Lockwood want? Flynn Lockwood wants to be a great scientist. But what does he really want? To be closer to his dad. That's what he really wants. And it's great to make your character that kind of dimensional thing. Right? It's great. Okay. Conflict. So I want to give you a brief, how are we doing? We're doing great. I want to give you this brief scene. Not that one, this one. For a conflict moment, what does the protagonist want? And this one's kind of fun because it's comedy.
Good afternoon, students. You've been invited here today to witness the 10th and final event in the competition between Mr. Eric Gordon and Mr. Billy Madison. Yes. As of this moment, Mr. Madison is ahead by 1 point. Each competitor will select the final category for his opponent. Mr. Madison will go first. Mr. Gordon, choose the topic. English literature. U.S. presidents. My Wife the Tramp. Burning Dog Poo and the Human Response. Reflections of Society and Literature.
Reflections of Society and Literature.
Good luck, Schmuck.
Mr. Madison, the Industrial Revolution changed the face of the modern novel forever. Discuss, citing specific examples.
Come on,
Okay. The Industrial Revolution, to me, is just like a story I know called The Puppy Who Lost His Way. The world was changing, and the puppy was getting bigger. So you see, the puppy was like industry, in that they were both lost in the woods. And nobody, especially the little boy, society, knew where to find them. Except that the puppy was a dog. But the industry, my friends, that was a revolution. Nib High football rules!
Mr. Madison, what you've just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
It's just a great moment there. But that's that conflict. There's that conflict. And here, it's a little different because it's inverted because it's a comedy, right? But here, and the music thrusts up, it's a conflict, and he's gonna make it. And of course, it just goes way the other way. It's not that he doesn't make it, it's that he totally doesn't make it. So enough that this is listed on YouTube as the worst movie insult of all times, which isn't quite true. All right, let me give you one more clever little device for your characters. And it's something you saw in Gladiator. It's called Save the Cat. What happens when Maximus is reaching down on the ground and he gets the arrowhead? And what's he going to do? He's going to jam it right in his face. And why doesn't he do that? That's the Save the Cat moment. What does that do to your character when you see that? Shows his morale, shows he even cares about that. It expands suddenly your character in ways that are just fantastic. Just a little twist there. There's all kinds of examples of that in different movies. And I'll suggest that we'll see a lot of those in RoboCop when that comes out, because it's going to be, is he human or not human? Will he save it? We also see them inverted in Bad Guys, where bad guys will gratuitously, why does Darth Vader go, and somebody strangles to death? It's the opposite. It's kill the cat, right? Of, oh, he's even worse than I thought. It's a great device there. Okay, and then finally, what you want to do with your screenplay stories is the thing that's going to make you really popular on the Hendrix campus, which is you want to test market it. So next time you're in the borough and you get a cup of coffee and you see some friends there, or people you like to be friends, or people you don't want to have as friends anymore because they won't after this, you say to them, hey, let me tell you about a story I'm working on, and you pitch them your log line. And if they go, oh, that sounds good, then a little bit more. And if they go, no, don't, then you just keep going a little bit more, depending on how you want the relationship to go. All right, well, thanks very much.